everybody. It is Cinnamon Cooney, the Art Sherpa, and today we are painting the butterfly, a butterfly with bokeh or bokeh effect that you see in photography. I'm going to show you how to create that in paint, and also this semi-realistic butterfly. We're going to kind of drill down a little more than we usually do, but I'm going to really explain to you how it's done so you're going to be able to accomplish it too. On the mic today is my husband, John.
Hi, guys.
He runs the multitude of cameras so that we can do this live show, and he reads the comments so I have some idea what questions you're asking. That way we can have kind of a conversation without me. If you've ever seen me read the chat, you know I just like look and read it, so it gets taken away from me. That way I can be more present with you. I'm very excited about today. There's been some interesting little hiccups.
Hiccups?
Hiccups.
What hiccups?
So I thought I had this stencil that had these different sized circles.
Yes.
And then I didn't have a stencil that had this different size circles. So I had to get one of these crafting punches.
Ooh, that's a heart punch.
That's what I had. And I thought, well, hearts would probably look good. I got these, like, they were doing this thing at Joann's where it was like, they were like a dollar or some crazy amount of money. And then I bought a bunch of different sizes just in case I ever wanted to punch. Or I don't know. Just in case. Do you guys ever buy heart supplies just in case?
I actually have to say that I think I remember going through and seeing those all on sale and going, ooh, isn't that cool? And
it,
I actually
isn't it cool?
I made them.
Little stencils with it.
Oh, yeah.
Hopefully you can see the stencils here like
oh,
this.
Oh, those are multi-sized. That's right.
Multi-sized. And hopefully it will be enough to get our effect. And I'll explain it. And you'll understand what it is. Do you have the photograph you can share with them?
So you know
what we're painting today?
I do, actually. Hold on just a second.
While John's finding that, you can locate this photo on the Facebook page right now, and I probably will tuck it over in Pinterest as well, and I'll probably make a traceable for this and have the finished painting up there. But we got to paint the painting. So here's what the deal is. Normally sometimes there it is, sometimes I paint the painting ahead of time, maybe even do it a couple times to work things out, and sometimes I just do something. And I thought it'd be interesting because you guys ask me all the time, how do you decide what colors you use, how do you, you know, break out what you're gonna do. And I'm like, oh, I could just show you that. And now you can see me make adjustments, you know, on the fly, so to speak, on the butterfly.
On the butterfly.
Since I don't have the round stencils. You do what I'm doing with round stencils, and it'll be that kind of... But, you know, the heart bokeh, bokeh, their bokeh. What is it? Bokeh. Happens. So here is my beautiful... Oh, I'm just seeing that.
Just you're seeing that.
Just I'm seeing that. All right, I'm going to put out my paint colors now.
Okay, hold on just a second.
My special tools I'll be doing today is I'm going to have a retarder and a glazing medium. Now, I've got two products here. I've got the acrylic retarder by Grumbacher, and I have my golden glazing liquid, which is both glaze and a retarder. However, I'm almost out of it.
Now, Marcy
And just ordered it, so then I grabbed my Liquitex glazing medium as a backup.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't act like this. This dries fast, this dries slow.
Okay.
So that's the difference between those two. I have some acrylic pens. I also have some detail brushes and some fluid paint so I can have some control over my color. I have two chip brushes. I don't know if you guys have ever seen these. They're like little chip brushes.
Uh-huh.
This is going to be to blend everything out. Don't panic if you're like, oh my goodness, there's so many tools. Don't panic because this is really doable, and I want you guys to always feel like this is something that you can do. I'm just going to explain to you how it's done. Sometimes things require a few tools, and that's okay.
Nope.
I put out titanium white.
Titanium white, yeah.
The materials are in the description below, as always. And we won't forget wishes. Don't worry, John.
No, I know. What is that? What color you just put out there?
Phthalo blue.
Now,
I'm going to put out some cadmium yellow hue.
Marcy was asking, do you need the gill tube ringer to begin the painting?
You mean the gill to begin it?
Yeah.
Well, if you have tubes and you can't get to the paint in your tubes.
You should push that forward a little bit so I can see that.
I can ring one for you. So here I've got my Grumbacher retarder and I'm down to the dregs.
You have to push it forward so you can see there. Oh, there you go.
Okay,
yeah.
So I'm going to clamp that in and then I can just very happily...
Not too much so you don't pop the
lid
on.
No, I just got it. Okay, I think that's it anyways.
There you go. That's good right there.
Yeah. So then this is now squeezed up and I'm not losing money.
Yeah.
I think this is in the description below. I got an affiliate link to this in the description below. This is the Gill Mechanical.
Oh, yeah. Now, Ian Jackson is the photographer of that butterfly, and he's here in the room with us.
Really?
Yeah. So thank you, Ian.
I did not know it was Ian's. I mean, I think I did. I'm having a morning. I'm not going to put out. I also have some cad red light hue. I'm not going to put that out yet, and I have Mars Black. But again, I've got some Mars Black that I'm not putting out yet, and I am going to put out a little burnt sienna because there's a couple places I might use it.
Okay.
No, but I'm going to try to not put out anything until I need it.
That was a question. Sorry, I misunderstood that. No, Ian is not the photographer.
I was like, boy, I'm having a moment because I didn't know that. I'm putting out the acrylic glazing. I may switch to the Grumbacher retarder depending on how it's going. The first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to start laying in my blended background. But first, I got to put wishes in. I know I've got a wish for Zoe.
Oh, yes, that's right.
I shouldn't use purple. That's not going to blend in nicely to this background at all. I guess I'll use this brownish red one. So we're going to wish that Zoe has a happy, peaceful time at school.
Mm-hmm.
And just kids in general. Everybody's nice. All right. And I think we have a wish for Rhonda because I saw a lot of people wishing Rhonda well-being.
Yes.
So well-being for Rhonda.
And if we could put one in there for Grandma Jean.
And another one for Grandma Jean. I'd also like to put a wish in for the bees.
Definitely for the bees.
Put a wish in that the bees are okay and they handle the pesticides and things that are killing them. Because, you know, I like honey and food and things in life. So wish for the bees. So like you do.
Before we jump on here real quick, I'm going to say we have a huge community. We've got over 270 people here just joining us for this painting. So I wanted to say thank you to everybody. Love that you guys are here. They're all complimenting your hair, Cinnamon.
Well, thank you.
Saying how good you look. And I wanted to say thank you to all you guys. If we could get a real quick wish in there for Kimmy and a wish for her good court date and disability. And a wish for Maggie's son. And for all those light keepers out here who are grabbing all the wishes, because we got a flood of wishes coming in there, capture those and put them on your canvases for us. We really appreciate that.
And we really, really do.
We really do. I thank you guys for coming and being here with us. I always love it. I know we got a big painting to go through here.
It's okay. That's me. Because I'll be like, John will be like, he always actually in life does this too. He keeps me a little bit centered. Because I can be a little like intensey worky.
Oh, and a wish for good brain surgery. We got to get that in there.
Dude. Yeah, definitely good. Whoever's having one today, good brain surgery.
Yes.
And I want your surgeon to be really on point.
And
so, for sure.
Yeah, again, love you guys. Thank you all for being here. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share. Do all those kinds of stuff. You know, we love to have you here with us, but. Yeah, go. Okay.
I'm going to go.
I'll let you go to paint. Sorry.
All right. No, it's okay. So here's the thing. I'm going to start out doing this light center that we have in our photograph.
Okay.
Right? Do we have the photograph for them to see?
I can pull it up here periodically.
Okay, cool. So we're going to pull out. See, just on the edge, you can see it's just dusted on the tip of this brush, which is a number 12 bright.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm pulling it out. And I'm going to get just a smidge of green here. And I'm going to really have this be quite bright. I'm going to add even a little white to it. And I'm going to get this glazing medium. And I'm going to start putting this light in the center here.
Mm-hmm.
This is going to be the first thing that I'm doing. I'm going to be a little heavier with my glazing medium, a little more white into that, not rinsing my brush, than I would be usually. And also I'm going to have to scramble away the words and into the paint, making them go into the universe. The reason I'm a little heavier on my glazing than usual is because I want my blending to last a little bit longer. And I may even have to switch to my Grumbacher retarder.
Mm.
Working those triceps out today. So I'm not being like incredibly careful or anything.
No.
I'm just trying to get this sort of value laid in. It's when I'm coming back working definitions, and you can kind of see I'm changing color directions. I'm brushing a bunch of different ways. If a streak gets in there, I'm blending it out because this part I will want a little bit blended. Right? So that's what I'm going to want. I'm going to pull out a little more green into my yellow, a little more green into my yellow. And I'm going to grab some glaze, and I'm going to come right here and work the ends here.
Now, while you're working that background in, I have this great community shout out that I want to give because Sonia says that the entire community up there at Alternative Inks is watching. They got a staff of about 15 people who are all in the office watching you right now up in Connecticut. So
Alternative Inks?
That sounds cool. Oh, no, that Alternative Ink, INC. So it's I'm not sure exactly what they do. Not like INK Inc. Like, Incorporated. Like, Alternative Incorporated.
Alternative Incorporated. That's pretty awesome.
So thank you guys for all hanging in here with us.
I'm going to put that brush down, and while this is all still wet, I'm going to get one of these chip brushes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to very softly, it doesn't have any water on it, look, blend across. Look at that. And this will soften that very much for me. And then I'm going to wipe it off.
Now, Tiffany says she's an amateur artist and wants to know, what does the glazing medium do?
The glazing medium, or the retarder at this stage, slows down the drying time of my paint so that I can really, 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 really blend these edges together. So if you see here, I'm taking my phthalo green out from the edge, working it into my burnt sienna, making a dark color, picking up my glazing medium, and I'm going to work this dark shadow I have over at the corner into this space. So now, because I have this glazing medium, I'm going to get a little more in here. I can put this right here, because what I'm trying to do is make all of this out of focus, and that can feel very challenging to artists. Now, putting this down, grabbing that dry chip brush, and very softly blending with this dry, clean brush paint into the paint. And see how it softens it?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, if the brush gets too dirty, you'll have several clean brushes you're using to blend. Because what you want is the softest, softest, softest line. And this is still going to need layers. Still going to need layers. Still going to need, you know, a deeper value here. But I'm going to keep working it.
Mm-hmm.
And I can come over. I can even add a little phthalo blue to it into my burnt sienna. And you'll see I'm getting an even deeper value, pulling in the glazing. And I'll come work this corner.
No.
And you're like, well, there's blue dots. What about those? Those are going to layer on top of this. And in bokeh, boy, the layering is going to matter. Because this is a camera's lens effect. This is not a life effect. This is something we see in our camera lens. But I think as artists and as creatives, we like to represent the things that are happening in our life well. I just reach back there to get some more that glazing meat. No, you'll notice as you're working, you're like, oh, I don't have enough of this. I need more of that. And if you do, you do, and then you just get it.
No, let me know when you have a...
I'm going to get another chip brush that's a little cleaner.
Okay.
And hopefully you guys can see this soften here.
No, MoCuts wants to
know... Softening.
Does my brush need to be real soft in order to get the softness in the canvas?
No. Chip brushes actually are not soft. What it needs to be is a dry, clean brush.
Gotcha.
So your first thing is you're laying in the paint, and then you're going to try to come back here and lay in the blend, right? Like if I really, really want to work this middle, this sort of space here, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'd be going through so many brushes. I'm going to come back to my yellow, a little of my yellow, and a bunch of my white. Maybe a smidge of my green in it, and then grab some more here. And then at this edge where these two are, put this color down, right? Because I want a soft thing here. Maybe I want it lighter, more blended. Putting that down, putting that color down. What am I going to go get? Clean, dry
brush.
One here.
trip it down. So,
I'm fine. See, I'm just blending it, and then, oh my gosh, it goes so... blended and soft. I'll wipe off if I need to.
Now you keep wiping that on your rag.
Because I'm taking off the extra pigment, or all I'm doing is just moving the pigment around. I'm trying to blend the pigment, not move the pigment.
Now, on that rag, do you just let those dry out and keep reusing them?
Yes. And then I wash them sometimes.
Okay.
And I try to make sure that they haven't stuck together.
Okay.
So see how I keep just working this softness?
Uh-huh.
That is my friend. And this is, okay, so acrylic artists just work a little harder for the blend than the oil artists do. But we can do it.
Gotcha.
We can absolutely do it. And I'm going to kind of...
I got something here for you.
Rinse out what you got.
Okay, so Alternative Ink is mm-hmm. Alternative Service Connecticut mm-hmm. Incorporated is a nonprofit organization dedicated to providing innovative support to children and adults with developmental disabilities. So Art, high fives to you guys.
Dude, seriously.
I thought that was just awesome. So
please feel
that.
Free to use any of the art here in your therapies.
Oh yeah.
Please, please, please. That is one of the things we have. Well, we don't let you know license the sip and paints. We do have a humanitarian license, and that's for like adult living facilities and care facilities.
Yeah.
Because it's so hard to come up with art education. I'm rinsing out my brushes and drying them off.
Yeah.
It's so hard to come up with art education, and it can be so cost prohibitive, especially for families and outpatient care, to be able to continue those art therapies.
You know, it really is. And yeah. One of the things that's really great is that we have a chance to be here and to celebrate with you, especially when we do things like this. And we go and we hit that 300 number.
No, we didn't.
We did. And we get the Sherpa up in here to get a little crazy, do her little dance. And we appreciate all you guys coming and being here with you. And don't forget to remember to get up and dance every once in a while. It helps remember, it helps remind your body that you're alive and we should all celebrate, even when she gets a little crazy. So, while you're here with us, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share. And post your pictures up there so that we can see them up there. And don't forget to hit the share button. We want more people out here with us so we can be doing these silly shenanigans with the Sherpa. So hit that share, post up on Facebook, and let's change the world with art. Right?
Yes.
Did the voice say it all right?
The voice said it all right.
And I love you guys. Thank you for coming and hanging out with us. It's awesome. Oh, yeah, we have over 200 likes already, too, by the way.
Oh, my goodness. Thank you so much.
So just sparkly awesomeness all over the place.
So much awesomeness. I'm pulling out a little of my green, and I'm working it over into my yellow. Right? And then back into my green. Just darkening it up a bit, and I'm going to get some of my glazing blending medium here, and I'm going to work these two edges together. Well, you guys, I hope you do this with me because you're going to love how it comes out. I hope. Because it's going to come out so good. So good.
Everyone says, what number do we need for John to dance? And mostly that's a number of, I have to push the buttons, so it's hard for me to run out there and dance. Otherwise, I would probably come and maybe do more of that. But soon we'll have more cameras. And we'll,
so you'll have more buttons to push.
And then well, we could have a camera semi-directed in this way so I don't have to like run so far to dance with you guys.
So if you guys didn't catch that, I mixed my phthalo blue with my burnt sienna and my green again and more glazing medium as I'm coming here and trying to work this effect because I know I want this to be a little darker here.
Uh-huh.
So I'm just making sure that value is here. And we all know what I'm going to do next.
Dry brush?
Dry brush, and okay. Hopefully these are dry enough. Just drying it up.
Sometimes I feel
trying
like
trying to feather it up.
Sound effects.
Soften it up. And then look, guys, this isn't like, it's not hard, but it's not completely like, woohoo, first time, you know. This is a technique. That's one anyone can learn, anyone can do, for sure. But if it's like something you got to do a couple times on, don't feel weird or bad about that. Ever.
So, Dana.
I'm going to keep working the blend here, Mr. Cooney.
Yeah, she was asking
some
about
more yellow.
Blending and glazing mediums.
Yeah.
So, Diana was asking, does the paint need to be loaded with a higher pigment density to use glazing medium? Because some student quality paints have different levels.
I feel, yeah. So here's what I feel. I feel like gallery acrylic probably be just fine.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like there's some craft paints that are just fine.
Yeah.
I feel like there's some student paints that don't bind and keep lifting from layer to layer, and that is not fine.
Yeah. So you gotta work, yeah, experiment with that. And
yeah, it that's what it is. A lot, though, sometimes the student paints have like gels and things in them as fillers.
Hmm.
And that will slow down their drying time and make them a little more fluid. I just grabbed white in my blending.
Gotcha.
And I'm coming right here with that. I'm going to get a little more white in my blending. It's a bit frantic at first, but you'll actually find it's fun. Now I've got these edges here.
So, yeah.
I'm going to take my other chip brush, which is now coated in paint by the brush. Make sure it's as dry as I can make it and blend these edges. My pressure is just super soft.
Shanaz.
Super soft.
Shanaz was asking how to keep it so loose, because she wants to make it detailed. How do you stop from getting too detailed and just keep it that kind of loose, you know?
So here's the thing on this, and I understand that because I used, you know, had a background where the art was maybe a little bit tighter than it is now. That's what we say when artwork is pretty representational.
Yeah.
It is experience. What's going to happen is you're going to paint and you're going to paint and you're going to realize there's essential things,
mm-hmm,
to make the painting work. This was like a 50-cent brush, so it's shedding a little bit.
Yeah.
Two brushes will give you an extra adventure level that you may or may not be up for. Easy on the pocketbook, stressful on the heart pressure.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so see that nice effect, how blendy-blendy that is?
I do.
It's blendy-blendy. And that's really, in this particular case, in acrylic paint, you guys ask me a lot, do I need the blending medium? Not for a lot of techniques, right? You can get an ombre, sky ombre on a painting without a blending medium. But for this kind of technique, glazing medium and a retarder are your friends. Because chances are, especially if you're a new painter, I'm like cooking along, so a lot of times I will just be wet into wet on my paint because I just move that fast. But you're at a different process, and you're working through the painting differently than I am, and you may not be there as quickly, so the retarder is your friend. Your cool. good friend.
Now, someone was asking, what is a chip brush?
So chip brushes are these weird craft paint brushes, and I don't even know why they're called chips. Now, do you know why they're called chips?
I thought that they were, you know, originally, the first time I saw a chip brush was like as a disposable brush in the like commercial painting world where you paint a house and it's used for like as a disposable cut-in brush.
Yeah, I think they use this a lot in the chalk paints for upcycling furniture and shabby chic.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot in the craft community.
So earlier, what Ian was asking is the photographer of the butterfly in the room?
I don't know. I don't know.
And Mona just said that that John Sandra is here, and he's the one who took the photo.
Love your photo.
So there you go.
You can explain the lensing.
Yes.
What happened in the lensing. Later, we're going to explain water drop lensing, and you're going to love it. But you can explain the lensing on why it did this while I try to fake the bokeh with...
And for all of you...
happy little droppies.
For all of the photography guys out there who know, I just got a micro four-thirds lens and the CS lens adapter with a 35mm micro lens, and it's awesome. So, all right, enough of the inside baseball.
We can inside baseball all day. If you guys want inside baseball, we'll inside baseball. We will do it. I'm going to definitely pull out a little white here and a little glazing here. And this is just almost pure white. There's a little pigment in the brush, but it's basically, and I'm going to come up here, and I'm going to create this highlight. Pulling it out. And it's dry. And you know what's happening to me here is the paint has held. It's okay, though. It doesn't hurt me because I need to lighten this area anyways. So the green is picking up a little bit, and I'm pulling this out and radiating it out. For where I'll be blending later. I've got a stippling brush to work a lot of this as well. I'm going to have to dry this background.
Okay. So there was a question about what bokeh is, or bokeh.
I will let you take that.
I'll explain that real quick. So when a lens has a narrow depth of field, what that means is that it can only focus in a very shallow area. It has a very wide open aperture, and it's only able to focus in a very shallow area. So everything in front of and behind of it goes out of focus. And the way that things go out of focus has a lot to do with the shape of the iris and the lenses inside that. And so a lot of photographers really like beautiful bokehs. And you'll find that some of them have really complex bokehs where they swirl to one direction based on, you know, the edge of the lens, to very simple ones that just form a reliable, like, octagonal or hexagonal pattern based on it. So these types of things are explored by photographers, and it's just an interesting side effect of how we look at the out-of-focus area and use it as an artistic element within the composition of a photo. And, hey, look, there's Luna. Oh, and I forgot to say, thank you guys for all being here. There's over 310 people here. We got 240 likes. And it's like, I really appreciate everyone being here. It's so awesome.
It is.
Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share. And I'm going to get Luna another bag of cookies.
If you've got to get Luna something, can you grab me a clean cup of water?
Yes. And they were asking...
I'll answer some questions real quick.
The quick question was, is why do you have why are you having so many glasses of water?
To get bright on muddy colors, you need to make sure that your water is clear and your brush isn't overloaded with pigment, so you're not getting grayed out experiences through complementary colors. In other words, colors that are in opposite places of the wheel can blur out, and then you'll have muddy colors. And so a lot of what I'm doing, a lot of this kind of effect is about keeping your colors clear. John sent me something. Okay, I think I've got all the... Rebel C says my mom likes your videos and she never likes anything I'm into. Dude, that's awesome. Multifamily generational stuff. You know, I don't know. John, give me questions. I think I answered all of them. Like, those are my questions. But I have no new questions, so I'm going to have to... I'm so glad I ordered another bottle of this. I get mine off of Amazon because I am... really unwilling to drive to downtown Houston is really what it is. They have it at Texas Art Supply. So I'm going to come back again with my white and my glazing here, and I'm going to just lighten this corner up again now that it got dry. It'll take you a little longer with your hair dryer if you're using retarders or slow dries, but don't worry about that. And the glazing allows a little translucency to the paint, so I can also have that to help me on my blend. I'm now curving my brush to the round, and I'm going to get a smidge, just a smidge. I've got to move the comment so I can see it. A smidge of the phthalo? No, sweetie, no, thank you. I'm just...
Sorry, just getting back.
No, don't worry about it. I'm just guessing. Is all. Guessing is hard. And I'm going to add just a blend of that blue here, and then I'm going to come a little stronger with the blue right here. And again, this is all soft brush pressure. The wonderful thing about this is how softly and delicately can you paint. Even when you're painting a big brush, the soft pressure will help you get the blends. You guys get to declare the hardness of this particular video at the end. You tell me how many hoots. And I'm going to come and add a little of this blue here, and then maybe a little spot coming out kind of round here. A little more blue. And let's hope that my brushes are blending again. Blendy, 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 blendy. Soften, soften. Two directions. Up and down. Back and forth. Softening, softening, softening the edge. Just a little. Just a little. So, softening the edge so the eye feels like it happened. All right, got a couple more of these.
Yeah.
That I'm doing, and then I'm gonna do some of the bouquet.
So, getting a little glaze. Sky is saying, what level of canvas do you use? I find mine absorbs so much paint.
Okay, so in my fine art practice, I don't like to be messed with, so I use Frederick's professional level canvases, and I just pay for those.
Yeah.
we paint so much here that it doesn't become cost effective. So I tend to use the local craft big box stores pack of five 60 by 20s, which is not a great canvas. It like fights the paint. They got a weird coating on it. Something's afoot. I don't really know. Something's afoot. I find I sometimes have to rinse my canvases off and let them dry.
That's what you're painting on right now. It's one of those.
Yeah, it's one of these. I have seen and I want to try out, there's an economy pack of boards by Fredericks.
Mm-hmm.
And it just made it. The only reason we haven't really gotten into it too deep on the channel is it's hard to get.
Yeah.
So I'm just blending this blue here. See, I'm just the soft brush and I'm blending. This is a little kind of movement from what we did with our hummingbird. And now, I'm leaving a little green there between these two.
If you,
and I'm going to come here and add a little blue effect.
If you would there, I'm going to pop open...
What?
I don't know why it's not doing that for me.
I'm going to come here and blue effect from this corner. Trying to sort of somewhat... Oh, just saw a place down here. This is another thing that happens to me when I'm looking at a photograph. Like, uh-oh, you had a blue spot too. I will blue spot you as well. Just now, making a little. I also, just so you guys know.
They want to see the picture. Can you pull this up for just a second here? I'm going to pull this over so you can see. Here we go.
Oh, so this is, I also print out a black and white of anything I'm painting. I look at a color version and a black and white version. This way I can see value.
Right. Now I'm going to pull this up wide on this so you can explain to them. I've got this.
So what are they saying? See.
I'll show that to you in just a second.
Okay.
They
keep blending here before it dries on me.
Here we go. Turn around.
Soften. It's like leaving your house when you've just grouted and you forgot to clean up. Don't do that. And also, don't let your paint dry before you blended it. Okay.
So I'll pull this back up here.
It's getting softer.
Because what I wanted to see here is see how they were questioning what the blue radiating circles were from. You see there? And then that's from the light sources in the background that are sort of delivering that. So that's what we're blocking in there.
I got a little big with this one up in the corner, but I'm not really worried about it.
Yeah, this is just to give those feelings. So once
we're trying to create those feelings. And then I'm going to come with my hearts and actually kind of even do it a little more through here. You know, I know I've got my butterfly that's going to come here and be central, and I'm just going to do some of that because I think that's something people enjoy. And I'm just going to work that background a little bit more because it needs to have some depth, which is what glazing is for.
Right.
My background again. Let's work it.
Okay. You need that.
Yes.
Okay.
You have been invited to the clinic. How do you feel about that? Welcome to the clinic. This is how it's done.
All right.
All right. So I'm going to keep working some depth and richness through here in the deep greens because we really have some.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like it. So I've just got the blue and the brown here, but I'm definitely going to grab a bunch of the glazing because I don't want it to be too opaque. And I'm just kind of breaking up the space. This is a light dusting. I'm just on the tippy tips of the brush.
Now, does the brush directionality matter here?
I actually try to change up my brush directionality a bit because what I'm trying to avoid is creating obvious lines. So if I can keep moving my brush directionality around, see how they're like all streaking this way? Streak, 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 streak.
Yeah.
If I come back and go the opposite way, look at how I make those brush strokes disappear. And then if I have to do it there, because they were all going up, up, up.
Yeah.
And then there's some here. So if I come across here, it just helps. And if I need a little more glazing medium, get a little more glazing medium, come back. Oh, soft. But oh, no. Soften, 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 soften. I'm softening this space because that's what you want. You want it to feel like there's value out of focus in the distance.
Yeah.
Right? I'm going to come here and kind of get that all in hand because that got a little cray cray in the hey, hey, cray cray. You know, this is really, really how it's done. It's a little more than what we maybe normally do on the channel. This is about, you know, where our landscapes are. But gosh, these art techniques, once they're mastered.
Yeah.
I'm going to pull a little of this into here and then blend it.
And so, I was explaining earlier that the bokeh is just that sort of the beautiful artifact of the camera being out of focus in front of and behind the subject matter. and how the shape of that bokeh is formed by the characteristics of the lens. So we're just trying to give the feeling of something being out of focus in the distance in a beautiful way.
In a beautiful way. I like that, like that, like that. I've got a little brown and the blue on here. I'm going to wipe my brush off because I'm going to do an interesting thing here. But I have that sort of grayed brown, right? And I'm going to come over into my blue. I mean, my white. That's the white. Goodness gracious. Let me go draw a clock now. All right.
I'm going to say
I'm going to add a little highlight through here.
Okay.
Just softly through here. A little more glazing medium will help me. And I'm just, see how the glazing medium allows enough of it to show through underneath that there is, and I'm just changing the brush stroke. Oh, I got some brush strokes. Soften, 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 soften. Oh, it's soften, 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 soften. It's actually kind of fun. It may not feel fun to you if you're new to it, but once you get used to it, it's really fun. And if you can pull it off, people will freak out. Because this is the foundation of good surrealism. This is the foundation of realism. It's understanding how these focuses are enacted. I'm going to get back into some dark color down here.
And while you're grabbing that color, I'm going to say thank you. We've got over 330 people hanging out with us in this beautiful big audience. I love to see Honor and Gail and Patricia and Jonah and all of our moderators, Alan and Mona and Mark and Kim Sim and Flame and all of our wonderful people are out here. So thank you guys for joining us. We love you. Love to see you guys with us. So
thank you.
Just hi.
Hi. I'm pulling my green blue and my burnt because that's my deep color. That's my chromatic shadow, right?
Yep.
And I'm going to work a little bit of this area, too, now with this next glaze. And you can see this second layer of glazing is just essential to getting this depth of color and, you know, and softness. This is where you're at, you know, you got to, these are those.
Haley's super excited about the butterfly coming in. She's like, I can't wait.
Who is?
Haley.
Hi, Haley.
I think that's it. Yeah, Haley. I'm pretty sure that's Haley.
I'm going to really explain that, too,
bad
sweetie.
Bad with names.
I'm going to explain that, too. We're going to explain the butterfly in depth. I know we picked kind of a complicated picture, but
this
I'd
is
like
really
to.
Nice. I think that everyone's appreciates the explanation that the background's supposed to be fuzzy and kind of, I think the explanation of how depth, you know, the depth of the field was good.
Yeah, well, this is how you create that illusion in a painting, that out-of-focus depth. Because sometimes as a painter, we put everything in focus. We have an infinite depth of field. We're always Ansel Adams.
Mm-hmm.
Do you guys remember Ansel Adams? Teeny tiny aperture, pinhole camera, look at the mountain all day.
Yep.
You could see everything as crisp as day from where you were standing to the mountain. But if I, as an artist, want to create that experience of emotionality and romance and dreamlike quality that sometimes experiences in life have, I better be able to blend out my background and get that pinhole camera and go, was it wide angle?
Wide
angle? I can't remember.
You want a narrow depth of field.
Yeah, narrow depth of field. Got to narrow my depth of field.
And what all that means is that it can only see a very sliver of focus. So it can't see things behind it or in front of it very well, only right what you're focused on.
So if the robot cam is down here, you can just see me just taking advantage of the glaze and just blending this edge and just really enjoying that.
Now, you dried this to put the second coat of color on, right?
I did,
okay.
Because I didn't want this color to lift into what I'm glazing now.
And that's why you use
dry the glaze, dry glaze, dry glaze.
Gotcha, okay.
Yeah, and that's when the oil painters go, uh-oh.
Yeah, lots of people are saying this is a really great photographer who took this. So thank you. Yeah. No, that's...
All were great photographers. To be real honest, it was hard to be the big one, and it kind of came down to, I feel like I want to teach some bokeh.
Yeah, just turn around. I'll let you see the picture up there real quick.
Yeah.
Thank you, guys. That's so awesome.
Look at how that's coming in. So you can kind of see how we're starting to get that effect of it being out of focus. No, we don't have oil paint. Don't need it.
Yeah.
This works. You know, if you were doing this, like, if I had watercolors, how would I do this? Well, honestly, if I had watercolors, I would do the whole background in watercolors, but I would do the butterfly and everything. Probably I'd finish it in pencil. to get that crispness, that difference in crispness. Luckily, with the acrylics, we can totally get that the whole way. Yeah. I'm going to definitely create a little feather there and some there. And so you can just see I'm just coming through, adding that second. Look at the little scrumble is nice. Because I've got the glaze, it also helps me blend. You know, if you don't have the tools on this one, it is more challenging. And it's, but you know what the good news is there?
Mm-hmm.
It's not you. I'm going to kind of break up this space here, and I'm going to get a little more glaze, but I've got some pigment on my brush.
Jen loves that you're doing a painting based off of the photography of the community. She wants you to do another one.
I think this is going to be something we do regularly because I think it's going to help some people kind of really grow. And also, I think it's exciting to see how photographs are translated into paint.
And I think it's awesome. We get to showcase some awesome photographers.
Oh yeah, it's always
going to
be your pictures. Yeah. I like that.
That's what I think is really cool.
I like
really cool.
Doing your pictures. I'm like, woohoo. All right. So I'm just kind of, you can see I'm just breaking it up. And where I have brush strokes, I just try to make sure I either scrumble or glaze or get rid of those because they are going to interfere with my background. Now, hey, if I'm serious and I'm entering something in a show and I'm about to like go head to head, I might spend a whole 2 hours on this just working it.
Mm-hmm.
Just working it. In this particular case, I kind of want to show you something else, though. I have a stippling brush. Just a cheap stippling brush that has some silver on it, which hopefully isn't going to mess with us.
Oh, no.
And I'm going to take my big little
Your big
heart
little
here.
Heart? Okay. What are you doing with that
That
heart?
I snapped. And I'm going to stamp
okay.
into the yellow and into the blue. That's not blue. Why am I saying?
I don't know.
I gotta,
yellowish blue?
I don't know. No, it's not yellowish blue. There's no blue. I have no idea where the word blue keeps happening. And I pulled out some glazing medium. I find with stipples, you just want to make sure that you get the extra off. It's loading. And maybe right here, I'm going to kind of stipple in if this one works. This one may not be a friendly one. This is just...
It looks like you're having to just sort of scrumble it on with that thing.
I want it soft, and the trick is about making sure that I don't, again, leave those brush marks. Let's see if we got it. Yes. See that there?
Oh, cool. It's very blended in there.
Glaze, 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 glaze. Make sure it's evenly distributed. See how that is there? No, not crazy glumps. Maybe one right here, right? But I'll face it kind of the other way because I don't want to create too much directionality. Boy, I'm just... Come on. I don't want... I know, it's like... This is easier on a board. But there it is. This is something that you see in... I'm going to come over and get some of this blue right here. Maybe glaze. This is something that you will see in some really cool Pinterest pins in photography where they've put this lens on that creates like shapes with the light dots, like hearts.
Now, why are you using the hearts?
Because I did not have my round stencils, which is what I was going to originally use.
Oh, so and what would the round ones do?
They would do the normal effect of the round.
Oh, like where it would create lens flares and
yes.
things like that. So you're making heart flares with the lens.
I'm making some heart flares. Be with me. I'm making some heart
because
flares.
They're kind of like, I don't understand why the hearts are relevant. So you could use a
you're
round
gonna
shape.
You're going to think it's so cool when I'm done, y'all. You're going to be like, oh, my gosh. She did the hearts. And I'm going to be like, yeah, I did. Yeah, I did.
So we're pretending that in this case we have a heart-shaped iris inside the camera.
Yes.
Inside
in this
the
case,
camera.
We are pretending that.
And it's a super awesome heart-shaped iris that magically captures heart shapes in our...
No, that happens. See that online. That is a thing.
I'm sure there's some Photoshop.
Matt has one. Watch the backside of your stencil getting dirty. So now I'm going to use a different shape. I've got a slightly smaller one, and this is key. when you're doing these is make sure that, you know, they're not all the same size. You want them to be different sizes.
Oh, there's some awesome heart emojis going up.
You'll love it. You don't know you love it, but you love it. You love it. You just don't know you love it yet. I've just grabbed some blue and some green. You can just see how it's just sort of in there. And I'm just making sure that it's soft. I want it to be soft. Now, one nice thing is when we layer it over each other, that.
Ooh.
I like it when we layer it over each other.
Ooh.
I feel like there might be one maybe here.
Oh, that's good. That one looks cool. I like how they kind of pop.
Yeah, they kind of are a thing, right? It's a fun thing. Maybe it's not a fun thing for you, super fun thing for me, and you all have been kidnapped. That happens.
Well, that's okay.
Right? Now, if you didn't have the stipple, I have an abused brush as well. So I could be like, oh, let's do some of this just white with yellow, right?
Well, before you do that, though, I have to tell you something.
Huh. Can I can't do it?
We hit double Sherpa. And it's awesome. I can't believe that. So thank you guys for coming and hanging out with us today. It is a fun, fantastic Tuesday that we hit double Sherpa numbers. We got over 350 people hanging out with us here today and making this awesome, awesome, right now, just bokeh background for the butterfly that's coming.
Yeah, it's very cool.
And I think that's pretty cool.
What I'm doing is I'm wiping off any excess paint because I don't want any excess. And there's too much blue on there, which is annoying me. I'm going to rinse it out. The blue snuck in.
The blue.
That's okay. If you have that happen on one where you're like, dude, I don't like how that snuck in, I'm going to get some yellow. Just straight yellow. And I just fix it. I make it my own. I'll be like, no. Same.
Yeah, piece 3601 was like, yeah, watch her with that rag. I'm like, yeah, you do. There's a lot of cameras that she's swinging that thing around in there.
I know. All right, I'm going to do the smallest heart now.
You are?
Yep.
Okay. Oh, yeah, that is so cool. The little one.
Yeah, it's just a little extra touch. Will I love it? Yes, I do. Does it give me an effect I like? Yeah, it does. A little bit of that extra. You could have done this with several circles and exacerbated your effect.
Yeah.
And that's just a thing that you can do. And I made that with some Joann's dollar stamp punches.
All right. So okay. Now what?
So now I find my hair dryer. And you guys don't notice that I got to bend down.
Okay. All right. So while she's doing that, I'm going to say thank you guys for coming and hanging out with us. I look forward to seeing all of your beautiful paintings that are coming up with bokeh backgrounds and beautiful butterflies and all the pictures that you guys are going to post up. So post them up on Facebook, on Pinterest, on Twitter, on our website, all those wonderful places. Hold on a second. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share. And if you're here, hit that share button. Share this up on Facebook. Let other people know that we're here and hanging out and having a good time, because we like having all you people in the room with us, and it's just a lot of fun. So thank you again for coming and being with us. I can't tell you how nice it is that to see all you guys out here in the chat and to be chatting and to read that as we're going through, and it's really just nice. So thank you guys. And yeah, that's awesome, Caroline. Art high fives there. I'm reading some of the comments here for those of you who got your shirts and your games and your cards. Thank you so much for buying that stuff from us and supporting us with those purchases. We really do appreciate it. You can find more of that stuff at shop.theartsherpa.com. Someone was just so you know, I'm kind of bad about plugging things, but someone was saying that they had their shirts on, they really liked them.
Thank you.
So thank you guys.
Thank you. I have a charcoal pencil in white.
Do you? Mm-hmm. Oh, wait. Say that again?
I have a charcoal pencil in white.
In white?
Mm-hmm. Because I want to sketch on this, but I want it to go away. My watercolor pencils don't like to sketch on a painting that's painted.
Uh-huh.
And my kid's chalk is too big, so I have a charcoal pencil in white.
Oh, neat.
So I'm going to kind of sketch in the direction of some things that are happening. I'm going to change something on my picture. If you put up the picture, I'm going to tell everybody real quick.
Okay, hold on a second.
And I'll tell you why.
Over here, and make that there, and then I go over here, and I hit that, and then there you go.
Okay, can they see the picture?
They can see this.
The bit that is going in front of the butterfly. The little plant bit,
yeah.
We are not painting that. We're going to pretend that's tucked behind him.
Ah.
So in art, when you're looking at a photograph, there are things that are insanely cool in a photograph that just are not fun artistically. And even sometimes if you're going to go in and be like, oh, I'm going to do hyperrealism and I'm going to do it big and all of that, right? You will still notice that those artists do edit and do make decisions about what should be in the image and what shouldn't. And I feel like, personally, artistically, that limb breaks the butterfly. The
gotcha.
Line.
Gotcha. So you're going to put it behind it?
I'm going to tuck it behind it.
Gotcha. That makes sense.
You don't even have to worry about that. We're just going to do the flower and some leaves and a stem.
Okay.
So that's what we're doing. And I'm going to come up here and pray that I actually made my... Nah, not really. Well, gosh, that's not making me happy. Let's see if you work today. Will you work? A little bit. All right. Watercolor purple seems like it's like, so just what I said wouldn't work, decided that it will, is what it is. So we've got this here, and I know that he is, I'm going to actually move this even up over my head so I can get the sense of what's happening here.
So if you have chalk, though, it's okay to use it.
Yeah, if you have chalk, my chalk just refused to work.
Gotcha.
And I just don't play. In my studio, you help out or you get out. just with art supplies, not like with people and stuff. So I'm going to put this little bit here, and I know that's going to be my flower. I've got some nice leaves coming off here that you can show. You know, some nice, just definite, like, leaf things. And just look at the picture when you're deciding where does stuff go. When I'm doing the butterfly, I know he is attached to the flower here, which is in this space, which means I'm just going to very lightly sketch in where I think it's going to be, so that I can put his body in relationship to where I want it.
Now, how many...
And I'm going to... He's sort of this weird little wedge shape. I'm just going to do his little wedge.
Is this a complicated painting, you think? Is it a one hoot, a three hoot, a two hoot?
I think that this is a two to three hoot.
A two to three hoot.
I feel like, you know, sometimes for me, I'll be like, oh, it's going to be really hard, and everybody gets it really easy. And sometimes I'm like, that's going to be so easy. And everyone's like, oh my gosh, what were you thinking? So on this one, I'm going to let the community rule.
Now, what'd you just do there?
I erased a line I didn't like. I used water on my brush. So on the watercolor brushes, when you're sketching, if you don't like the line, I'll show you right here, I can erase it.
Just
with the wet brush.
Because it's a watercolor brush.
Mm-hmm. But then if I do like it, even though it's wet, I can sketch it back in because it comes off in water. It's a really useful tool.
Oh, neat. And it doesn't matter what color you're using.
Mm-mm. Yeah.
On a watercolor brush, on a watercolor pencil, because
it can, because, you know, like if I were going to paint everything all yellow, like the purple would not be an ideal thing. But here's the deal. It's what I got today, and I'm not going to let nothing stop me.
All right.
From doing this.
It's
so I'm pulling
half.
The arc of, and yes, of course, I am going to do traceable. Because, again, I'd rather you learn the techniques and not worry about the drawing part. But I'm going to do his little edge there, and then I've got another little wing right here, don't I? That I've got to draw. What I love is it's actually, believe it or not, a little light. It got lightened in the lens flare. I don't know I'm going to paint that lightening.
Now,
haven't decided yet.
Wendy would like us to put a link to the reference photo. Can we do that?
It's on the Facebook page, and I Yeah, definitely. Well, and we'll I think we're also going to add it to Pinterest.
Yeah, we'll see what we can do. We'll talk to the photographer and see what we can do to work out making it
easier. Well, and the name is credited in the description.
Yeah.
So I think we can stop seeing the photographer if anybody just reads the description.
I can do that. Look at that. Look at me. I didn't even know that, and I could look over here.
Yeah, of course. Like, right. Like, if I'm going to use one of your submitted photos for the show, guys, you're going to be credited like I would credit any artist that I'm working with or am inspired by.
This photo by Sandra Hege.
Sandra Hege is the photographer.
Am I saying that right? Hege, yeah.
There you go. Now, I'm going to just let myself know I've got some antenna, and they kind of do this curl back thing, so I just want to make sure I don't lose that.
Sorry for all the times that we've said who the wrong person was on this. I'm just like, you know, I'm...
It's just...
I have my head in this keyboard.
Head in the keyboard. I'm going to put some more paint back out. More paint back out. Pretty much all the same colors I had actually go into him and the flower, so that's going to be easy. And I don't really need blending medium for this part, I don't think. I'm going to add the black because I will need that. I learned from somebody posting that that little dot on the lower wing means it's a boy.
So Sandra was here earlier.
And we didn't say her name correctly?
I think
is that
did.
What we're saying? Is that what happened? Do we suck?
Mona was saying, Mona.
Do we suck?
So I'm going to say thank you to our beautiful community managers and heart keep and light keepers and
just
moderators.
Everyone who comes and paints too.
And everybody else in here, you guys do such a good job of trying to help us stay on track of everything. We really appreciate it. So thank you, thank you, thank you.
Lord knows we need it.
But yeah, we need it. It's like it Lord takes a tribe knows. And it's a good thing we have one.
Yeah. It really does, at least for us.
Yeah. And look at that, 333 people watching and 333 likes. Love that. That's so awesome.
Thank you, thank you. I mean, I know this is a little more of a thing than we normally do, but it's a fun thing.
And Sandra is here, and she says it's totally fine for a link.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Sandra.
Thank you, and for your understanding, Sandra.
And for my boot in mouth disease.
I have got this small number 6 shader.
Yep.
It's a short handle. And the reason is that I want a nice, line for the stem. And I'm going to do my darkest color first.
Yeah.
When I paint this in. So I'm going to mix my dark color that I have all throughout the painting, which is the phthalo blue, the phthalo green, and the burnt sienna. It gives me just a fabulous, fabulous deep color. I mean, you could use, you know, the Hooker's green if you wanted to. And one of the things that I want to make sure that I paint in is the joints. So I'm going to kind of put like almost like a little elbow in the stem where I'm seeing the joints. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be important for me later. Definitely where this flower goes off, I'm going to add that little elbow. These are little thickenings in the stem where I'm going to say, oh, hey, maybe a leaf should come off here. Little subtle things like that can be important when you're painting something, so that the eye knows what it's talking about. When we do that rain splashing in a puddle, there's just going to be a place always where the raindrop hits and the water splashes up that there's a shadow.
Now,
and you can learn that. You can understand that, and then you can do it.
Wendy was asking, what's the funny gray paper you have your paint on?
Oh, so this, we use the gray one here. This is Gray Matters palette paper by Richeson, I think.
Yep.
Richeson.
Can you show them the front lid to that real quick?
Maybe.
Maybe without messing up the painting. Let's see if we can go to there. Yeah. For just a touch more. Yep, that's it. The Gray Matters palette paper.
Yeah.
And that stuff's pretty good stuff.
Well, this is really great if you're painting outdoors or if you're in an extremely bright studio like we are, or you have cameras trying to see stuff, because the gray allows you to see the colors more accurately.
Yeah.
But, you know, I also use Strathmore palette paper as well. Now, my stem is getting thinner as it grows out, like our usual stem rules do apply. And we'll show this here. I'm going to do a very light line here. It just comes up a bit, and I'm going to just put some soft lines off here. Now, I've got a little leaf that's going to come off canvas over here. So he comes down. He's a little narrow at the stem, and he widens out. And that's what he's doing.
Mm.
What's his friend doing? Let's find out. We have a friend here who's got a little bend. And he's got a little leaf that goes like this. We like that. You can have a soft, I'm going to, you know, get a little softness here. And then there's a little leaf I'm going to put over here. But I'm going to do it real light because it's blended away. See how light it is?
Mm-hmm.
Like you can barely see the pigment. I actually probably won't have to do more to this one because I'm trying to say this is in the blur.
Oh, the lightness,
the pigment it being see-through is my friend.
Oh, I see. So you're, this is part of the camera playing.
Yep. What's in focus? What is lost focus?
Gotcha.
So here at this joint, I know I've got a little leaf coming on here. And this one is more in focus. Goes right across the hearts here. But they're kind of nice that they're here. And you'll find that their layering behind stuff adds an element of, ooh, Pinterest-tastic shareability.
Ah.
Right? What do we all want to share on our Pinterest page?
The awesome paintings we do.
The awesome paintings that we do. And we, because certain things.
I like to go see them all.
Like to go see them all.
Ah.
So I'm going to bring this open a little bit. So this is across that. And then tucking over. Can you guys see that line?
Yeah.
So the underneath of this will be darker than the top. I'm going to go a little bluer with that. And you can see the little fold over. That fold over is going to give some dimensionality to that leaf and your leaves everywhere. One leaf with a lot of dimensionality does a lot for a piece. Does a lot. You can do it. I know you're like, I don't know what you're talking about. This seems like a bunch of crazy. I'm going to do the little leaf down here.
Everybody really loves the description of this. This is really helping a lot of people out, I think.
I'm so glad.
And like this, this is great. We got over 340 people here hanging out with us. We're 365 likes already. Thank you guys so much. Just can't say that enough. It's really nice to have you guys out here with us.
So I'm just adding a little more pigment to my space because this is going to definitely be layered up. And I can add a soft bit of business. It's sort of like, barely coming off here that we can kind of see, but it isn't really. Maybe a little one right here behind our butterfly. And then there's a little, just very softly, a little bit of business here. And there, just soft, just not a lot. Now, I'm going to rinse out my brush. Look at my stuff. My highest highlight on this is in the center. So the next thing that I got to do is make a pretty bright green. And in the center of my stem, still leaving the dark on either sides, I'm going to add that color. Still in there. And that's going to come on the second part here and definitely on the top here. Definitely put that on the top there. So I'm looking at where is my light causing a lot of the reflection. And how can I show that? Now on the edge of this, I can come and very softly add this highlight to the space. But interestingly enough, I'm going to come back into my deep green here for this lower leaf. I don't want it as bright. It's out of focus. It's coming off the canvas. Right? Out of focus, coming off the canvas. I'm going to grab a little more of this right here. And on the edge here, put a little bit. Don't lighten the whole thing. You still want to keep a shadow. And if you've got to go back and get your shadow again, which is the brown, green, and blue. It doesn't take a lot to make it. You can come and, in places where it's necessary, pull that definition back. Shadows are as important as highlights. Paintings are won and made in shadows and highlights. So having this shadow here is going to be a big deal to the stem. Coming right underneath this leaf and shadowing this halfway point of the leaf, leaving the slightly hinted highlight there is important to your leaf. Now, wipe your brush off. Come pull your white out, but it has pigment on it, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, it does. And just very carefully run a little thin line. Not solid. I like to break it up. I'm going to come right along the top here with that highlight. Along the top of this. I'm leaving the dark line here, the dark line here, even in the center of this. And then I'm going to come right on the edge of this leaf with that. Look at that. Now we have a fairly defined stem that we can work with. Right? My next favorite part is I'm going to pull out some yellow, but I haven't rinsed my brush because I don't want it to be wholly bright. And I'm going to get a little of the green again. And I'm going to pull these bits that become the flower out. Wipe your brush off. Pull your yellow. Again, not wholly rinsed yet. And you can blend what will be the flowers out with that. And you definitely want to pull a little of your burnt sienna. And interestingly enough, your cad red light. And let's make some burnt, kind of dried out bits that we're seeing tucked in to where this flower is, isn't it? Have those. Those are fun. I'm going to rinse out my brush just a smidge, but not too pristinely. I'm going to pull out my white paint. It's okay if some of that pigment gets in it. And I'm going to start pressing down little flower petals. Little flower petals are getting pressed down. I love this little flower. You can brush some soft, distant parts of it, and then where it's more defined, you can show that it's more defined. Look at that. Isn't that pretty?
That's beautiful.
Isn't that just lovely? And it's just a lovely little thing, and we love it so much. It's just a lovely little thing, and we love it so much. Just a lovely little thing, and I love it so much. I'm going to grab a little of my burnt sienna and my cad light, loading it on my brush just a titch, and kind of brush off the extra. I'm going to come into my yellow here, and it's going to kind of goldenrod my yellow. Can you see how that's goldenrodding my yellow?
What number brush are you using?
I think this is a number 6 short-handled shader.
An abused...
This is a very abused brush. But what you want here, what you want as an artist, is to paint the brush that you have control over. Paint the brush that you have control over. And I'm just putting this on here, this sort of goldenrod. See how it's not a bright yellow?
Yeah.
But it has that feeling in it. And if you need to, and I might need to because I'm having a moment here, put out some glazing medium. What is up with my glazing medium? Pour out some glazing medium. This is just the Liquitex glazing, so it will dry quickly. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But it will keep my paint, you know, kind of actively on my brush. And I'm going to come and just paint in this wing with this first value. The nice thing is sometimes the glazing will extend your paint, and the soft glaze can help you get a blend that you might have trouble getting other times. I'm going to just make sure this is here because so many layers are going to happen on this butterfly, and you're going to really feel this butterfly. Well, the goal is to really feel this butterfly. I'm making a lot of assumptions.
You feel the feels?
Well, what I'll tell you is that normally when I do paintings, right, what do I do? I paint it, and then we film the beginning at the end.
Yep.
So we really know what we've given you. Right now, we're being cheeky, assuming we're giving you anything worth watching. Very cheeky. Very cheeky.
We're going on the fact that we're going to entertain you while we're doing this. So
yeah. Because you know what? On a live event like this, you could be like, it could all go wrong for
right.
her. And you would be sorry. I'm coming back and getting a little more of that brown value.
It could be 2 hours of a slow train wreck.
Could be. Hopefully not 2 hours. Where are we at?
I don't know. We've had pretty good pace step today. It's like an hour. I want to say we're just a little over an hour right now.
Okay. I think maybe we'll be good at an hour and a half, I think.
Yeah. We've been cruising right along today.
And this is really quite a painting to take on. But it's so wonderful, and it's so wonderful to know you can do it. I'm going to put a little more of this brown pigment right here. Just because it's a nice deeper value. It's great to know that you can do this, and I'll have to do his little details a little more on this wing once I get the black paint out. Well, if you want to work it out at this stage, you can. If you want to go through and figure out his exact rippling at this stage, I mean, it's not gonna. Oh, I've got it right here. I don't know why I keep looking back.
Cause you like it. It's good there. I need to put another one over there over your head.
Well, no, it's okay. Cause like. The black and white, again, helps me see other elements of the piece that I need to see. And then the color helps me see what I'm working at. So this is like that base of him.
Yeah.
And he is pretty fantastic. And now we're going to be paying attention to maybe some values and tones in his wings.
Now, Gail's asking, why isn't the paint sticking well to the butterfly?
To him?
Yeah, it looks like it's all just sort of see-through and kind of blotchy.
It is. And I want it see-through and kind of blotchy at this stage.
Is that because of the glazing medium?
That's the glazing medium and the fact that I'm glazing these colors on. Sometimes I think when you guys are painting and it gets like this, you go, oh my gosh, the paint's gone crazy. And I go, ooh, it's an opportunity.
Ah.
So hopefully we're going to get you guys where, you know, when things sometimes maybe like come back and you're like, I don't know what it means. You're like, it's an opportunity.
Now, have you painted? Someone was asking, so how did you work out this painting? Did you draw it or do a study beforehand?
You're seeing me work it out right now, real time, live. Nothing.
Oh, why not? Why don't you prepare better for these?
Is that what I'm being asked?
No, I'm asking
you
that. I think they were asking you what your preparation process is, and then there's
okay,
me
so
over here going.
Okay, so depends on what it is, right?
You should have like, more of a preparation process.
Look, you guys, I do a thing called pop-up shows. That you come in at like crack of dawn and you throw down your easel and hopefully remember your paint. And in 720 minutes, you go from nothing to a painting hanging on a wall in a gallery that hopefully sells.
Hopefully.
Sometimes they provide you a model.
They generally all sell out.
Yeah, they do.
And people buy them before they finish.
Yeah, because they get all excited. It's very exciting. I've just made some. I've taken the CAD red light and the CAD yellow. And I'm pulling at the glazing. By the way, yes, you guys could just use CAD medium. I'm just showing you some difference. So I'm going to just dust this slightly oranger value here. Just layer it up. Soft brush pressure here. Yeah, so this is comfortable space for me. Like, when I look at a photograph, I have enough experience in my life where I have a pretty good idea of what I got to do to break it down. The fact that I can explain it to you is the unusual part. Hopefully I'm explaining it to you. That's an assumption, isn't it? So I'm adding a little bit of this dust. This is just a slight value, but it will show up to the eye. And it's something that you're definitely going to want to have in there is that slight value. Pull out a little more yellow. You know, maybe blend the ends here. We'll come back and do some blending. And then I'm going to come back with this next... Coming right over the top, glazing it. Glazing.
Ian's like, what more preparation do you need than a sippy sippy and a brush?
I don't really, me, not a lot. You know, sometimes like if a design is complicated or I haven't worked out a design, like with the waterfall, I had a whole bunch of studies because I was like, branch here? Nope. Branch here? Nope. put the branches, there was those falls were painted a lot of times, so I finally decided I would like two branches here, and that's it. Because you have an idea, and then you want to do it. But when you're working from a photograph, you know, you're pretty much, the idea, the photographer did the heavy lifting for you. You've got to do some heavy editing, but the photographer did most of the work.
Thank you, Sandra.
Thank you, Sandra. We appreciate it. So I'm going to wipe off my brush. And now I'm going to start applying some of my brighter yellow values. I'm going to get a little white. Here's a little tip. Yellows tend to be very, very light on pigment, even the good ones.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes adding a smidge of white, especially in student paints, can really help your yellow perform better. And I'm going to mid-tone the wing with this light yellow and white. It's kind of an ombre, like my hair. That's this year's word, isn't it?
Ombre.
If we were to like do a look back.
A word cloud.
A word cloud on this year would be like ombre. Sherpa said ombre a lot. She also said like you do a lot, but ombre is helpful.
Mm-hmm.
So we're just seeing this subtle blend. Sometimes these, to get these big results, it takes, you know, these little steps.
You're taking lots of extra time to put the layers in.
You take the extra time to put the layers in, but look at that beautiful blend on that wing.
Yeah, it really is nice.
Pick up a smidge more of white and a little glazing medium. And I'm going to come right here, just to the tip, and lighten just this up very softly. Will it make a difference later? Oh my gosh, yes it will. Yes, it will. There you go. Light, light, light. Doing it here now. Wipe off. Grab paint. Ombre again. It's just all you're doing. You're just like, oh.
Gonna ombre it up.
Ombre. Ombre. Yeah. Fun stuff to me, though. Just blending it out, letting the pigment. And now the wing is very subtle. It's almost like airbrushed, isn't it?
Yeah.
I really love this. This is really fun for me. I don't get to do this on YouTube a lot because, frankly, there's this huge time pressure for videos to be a certain length. And not from, you know, YouTube or anything corporate, just from, you know, new viewers. Community usually gets it. They're like, yay!
Yeah.
So I like to, on occasion, do a video that's just for you guys and isn't about, you know, anything other than helping you work out a technique.
Yeah.
I am blending this here. We're going to have a bunch of black over here. So will I have worked really hard to work this out where I'm going to have black? Yes, I will have worked it very hard. Will it be wonderful, though, the little bits that are showing when I finally work out my black? Yes, it will. And that's what you've got to realize is those little bits that are showing will make a difference to the eye. And people will be like, I don't know why, you're just so good.
Mm.
You'll be like, I'm good because I work really hard. You know? Actually, you know, I'm very, very lucky for the most part. People are pretty nice. You know, I mean, like when you art, it's not like people get mad at you for arting in general.
Yeah.
They're not like, oh!
Generally, people are like, oh, awesome, you're doing stuff.
Yeah.
I see it, too.
I know we got some people in our lives that maybe don't do that.
But not here.
Not here.
So,
and not in general.
Speaking of which,
look at this beautiful. I love this color, so now I'm going to dab this into the wing a little bit because I just love it. It's like this cool marigold, and I can't help putting it around. This is something, if you can make a practice of it as an artist to do, is be like, ooh, yummy color. Distribute the yummy color always.
Oh, yeah. So, we have
come back with another highlight of white to pop that flower.
We've got over 360 people here and over
360 people here.
And I just want to say thank you to all you people for hanging out. And don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share. And post your pictures up on Facebook for us. We love to see those. And share this on Facebook so we can get more people in here with us.
If you think people should paint a realistic butterfly, boy, share that on Facebook because this is it. See, because we are doing bokeh, and we are, you know, look at that. That little layer there, that popped it, didn't it?
Yeah. I think this is so cool. This is one of my favorite paints.
You can come back. If you find that your paint has darkened or is showing too much of the canvas underneath, I'm going to come back and add a little bit of yellow here at some of these stems. Isn't that nice?
That's beautiful.
just, you know, go, oh, what do I need? Where do I need it?
I'm, you know, that's them. So awesome. I'm that's really so coming together. I love the hearts. I'm just super impressed by this.
I like it. I do like it. Now, okay, the patterning, right? Because right now you have a beautiful dreamlike butterfly. Why do we want to do this? Because I might do some lunar moths later, and we need to have all these techniques to do dreamy lunar moth.
I love the
dream
moths.
Girl milk eye techniques.
Some Luna inspired stuff.
If we're any of us are trying to get to the Jasmine Beckwith, if any of us are trying to get to that kind of art space, this is a great exercise to that space. All right, we're gonna get my detail brushes out.
While you're doing that,
I'm gonna get a number two shader. You guys know I like this because it gives me some control, and I'm gonna start trying to very accurately understand what the heck this pattern is.
We have to say hi to Miley.
Hi, Miley.
So big art high fives and hugs
art to high
Miley.
Five,
she's
Miley.
Turning 20. She's turning something on the 24th. She's turning one, I think. Is it exclamation mark? So I think it's a capital.
Is so it one?
I think it's a one, but there's a little exclamation mark
hi
in
Miley.
There.
Miley.
Little brush.
So whatever age you are, I hope you're kiki. Celebrating it like you're just
Millie.
A year.
I think it's Millie.
Millie?
Millie. M-I-L-L-Y. Millie. And
that's Millie.
And little brush kiki.
Jess, can you believe we were allowed to name children?
Addie.
Oh, and
names. Everybody says you
I got one coming at me, John.
Oh, you should. Oh, she's giggling. So I think what it is that we
go
have.
Go say hi to the people with Dad.
Come over and say hi to everyone, Luna.
Say hi to the people.
Say thank you for the 400 likes.
Hi for the 400.
Say thank you.
Thank Dad.
For the 400.
She has her first dance class today. Grandma Ginger hooked her up with some dance classes. She's pretty excited.
She's got dance class today.
Are you out of TV?
Well, I got her. So you
no?
Tell
me. No. Get her. Dad's got to give you the hug for me. And then I come hug you. She's so cute. She's really sweet. All right. So butterfly. Butterfly, butterfly, butterfly. Oh, you want to just grab her for a hug? Okay.
I left you on the wrong screen. Look at that. Oh, my gosh.
It's okay. I don't know what it was.
Sorry, guys.
All right.
I was on the pallet cam while
I'm
I gave
come
my
along
kitty
the
kiss.
Front of this wing, of which I am fairly sure I know I have this black line.
Oh.
That's a place I know I've got a black line, isn't it? And I'm going to have to really, really break this down. So, like, one of the things I'm going to be doing is we're going to talk about this a lot in realism coming up, which is how do you eat an elephant one bite at a time? I break images down into small space.
So I'm going to have to come up and dance with you in a little bit. Because
are
you? Hit 400 likes, and they're all like, John, you got to come dance. And I'm like, okay, I'll come up there, and I'll do a dance with you. And just
oh,
do
anytime.
But I'll let you paint in some of the wing first, and then we'll do that.
All right, I'm going to put in this little...
Stall successful.
...angled part of it. This is where the time is going to come in for me. I'm going to add this little black part to the front of this wing that I know that I've got right here. Right here, adding it just very lightly. I don't need to really work it in. I just need to know it's there so that when I'm trying to do this part, I know what I'm doing. And then I know I've got a little bit of a triangle happening here in a stripe and a little bit of a stripe here. And it's okay if you let the edge feather because the pattern is soft at the edges with these. And then quite deep in color, almost lamp black at the centers. But sometimes in these little edges here, they're not. See how I'm letting the little brush kind of work it? Just breathe. And then I'm going to let John come dance with me before we finish out the pattern.
Is that what you're going to do?
Mm-hmm. I have to get a change of shirt. You're going to change your shirt? So? Somebody else's brand. I don't know. It's Loot Crate. Do you Loot Crate? We Loot Crate. We like Loot Crate. You know I can't go too long because I can only stay in here until the oven cooks me. And then I'm like, realism is over. Hopefully you appreciate the drilled down element of this. Let's give it a dancey dance.
A dancey dance.
I wish we had a glitter sparkle party song already.
come out there for a moment. That'd be all weird. I don't know why you guys want me to come out there and dance with her. She's the person who we want to see dance, not me.
Yeah, no, we want to see you dance too. No, tip with all your detail brushes, if you've rinsed them out in water, wipe the handle because otherwise it will wick and drip on your stuff and mess you up.
Why would it do that?
And you want to be in control. And I may need to thin out a good amount of this black paint.
What is that?
Well, because the flow of the paint is super important. So I'm adding some water to this to fluid it out. Your other choice would be to have a fluid acrylic that's already thinned. But you can add up to 30% water to acrylic and not underbind if it's a good paint.
Okay.
I do think some of the paints out there underbind, though.
Yeah?
It's a feeling that I have because of you guys reporting to me.
We've seen some stuff.
We've seen some stuff. So I'm going to make sure that this is deep black. It's important. Come back and there's a micro dot here I'm looking at. So I guess I'm just reproducing what I'm seeing. Now here, this line will be a little bit thicker. And then it's going to come back here. There we go. I imagine these butterfly wings are a lot like fingerprints. They have similar patterning.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, right? Now, this has this ever so slight lightning right there at the wing. It's a weird thing I can see, so I'm going to make sure I duplicate it. And then there is a little line that comes back. This one was a little harder for me to see because the plant's in front of it. And when you're working with a photograph and you have to edit a part out, you may have to look at another reference photo to make up for the information that you don't have.
This is really cool.
I am going to say that there is a weird little shape right here that I'm duplicating. And then it comes out to the wing a little bit like that.
Now, if you're going to have any underbinding occur, how quickly do you generally see that happen?
Okay,
I'll let you focus on this. You're like...
Yeah, I got to really focus. So what's happening to me right now, guys, is even if I was teaching this and I'd practice this and all that, I would still have to focus on what I was doing a little bit because I have to really pay attention to what's happening on the wing, and it's easy. I'm dyslexic, so it's easy to get lost.
And so now you're trying to add the little...
In what's happening. Yeah. Yep. All trying to lines. Add these little bits that are going on. This one is giving me mental moments. So
you're doing
I definitely
great.
Have a line coming from this to this. And I'm looking at my black and white reference right now, and I'm just trying not to deviate. I'm not generalizing. I'm not anything. I'm just trying to say, I see this.
Yeah, those
you know.
You look over on the color one behind you. I think I've got it pulled up for you.
Yeah.
The little fine ribs that connect to the...
Oh, it's just such a thing. And you're just trying to say, all right, well, I know I've got these little dots. You can see where having it all blended in before you even put the black in can kind of help you because you're not going to easily get in and blend these little dots.
Could you sketch this in by pencil if you needed to first?
Yeah, you could sketch all of it in by pencil if you needed it to first. Whatever you're doing, however you get this in, just... Break it down how I'm handling the sheer magnitude of the detail here is I'm saying, all right, one bit at a time. Don't take on the whole thing. Don't take it all on. Take on a little bit of the thing. Trust that if you do that in spaces, that what's going to happen is it's going to come together. And it can be a little scary at first. It really can, because you're like, wow, this gets overwhelming. There's a lot happening visually. That's what happens to people in drawing. There's a lot going on visually, and it gets overwhelming, and they chew too much of the whale, chew too much of the elephant. They take on too much of what's happening in the image at a time instead of saying, you know, I'm just going to handle this part of the image. So I'm going to let this rest here for a minute for me mentally.
All right.
Okay. And the picture, for me, the picture just needs to be up.
Oh, is it not?
Yeah, no.
Sorry.
Just no. It's okay. I love it. I love seeing the work. It just, for me, there you go. All I got to see is the picture. So I see on his little head here, he's super cute, and he's got this little racing stripe that comes back a little bit towards here. And then he's got a little racing stripe at the top. There's a little bit of black happening here. And then he's got a nice little stripe coming down here. See, I'm just I'm not trying to take in all the pattern of him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, observationally, what I'm noticing in him, and this is a great time to notice things, because later, if you painted five or six of these, you're going to notice something probably like, hey, this black stripe often corresponds to a leg.
Now, if you're having trouble with with fine lines, do you have any suggestion for that?
My suggestion is improve the brush and the flow of your paint, and then your hand pressure. So a fine line is always a balance between the quality of your brush, that would be a good place to spend money, the fluidity of your paint, either you're thinning the paint with water or you're buying a fluid paint, and the gentleness of your brush stroke. And when you find a balance, when you find a balance between all of those things, you will achieve fine line. And what I want you to know is no matter where your line is at right now, know that you can.
Gotcha.
Right? And somebody else's ability to do it doesn't have anything to do with your journey at all. Like, if the wonderful friend you had over for a painting party today is like, oh, fine line, super easy for me.
Mm.
Bless your friend. Love your friend. And realize their journey is not your journey. As long as you know you can get the line, you're okay. That's the important thing. Oh, my goodness. More info. This wing's info is really quite something. And I'm going to be working it. So the first thing is that I've got to thicken and darken that line. But as it goes, I'm now going to have to kind of mix a gray-yellow, I think. Yeah. So I'm going to have to take some yellow out and come over here and mix a little black into it. And then a little white into it. To get what's happening on this wing a little bit. Hopefully it will stay wet for me long enough. Oh, that's going to be a thing. That's going to be a thing for you, too. Have fun with that. No, just kidding. First, I'm going to get in the good, easy blacks to process. So one of the good, easy blacks to process on this wing is this first wonderful little stripe here. Right? Glazing can also help you, too. That's another way you can get that yellow-gray would be glazing. So don't feel like you can't get it. Don't feel like this isn't doable. I think a lot of artists run the time lapse on this on YouTube because they know that this is a marathon. Definitely not a sprint. And yeah. Sometimes, you know, the attention span is a sprint. The problem with that only is that it's real easy for me to understand the process, but if I were a really new painter, I wouldn't even have any idea what went into building that image.
Right.
And even if all you take away from this is like, oh, I think I understand what goes into building one of these complicated images, that's still a win.
Yeah. And we're approaching our 2-hour mark, so we'll probably have a real short Q&A after this if we have one.
Yeah.
Because we're going to try to get the...
Yeah, it's like the background went in, and then the butterfly is like...
Yeah.
Shh. Sorry, guys. Just what it is. One thing I'm noticing now as I'm getting into this, and this will happen to you too, you will start to see, oh, I underpainted the wing. I didn't make this nearly as long as it needed to be. So now I have to move that back. I have to think about that now.
So is it now a good time to ask a question or?
Yeah, you can ask a question.
Okay, I just know if sometimes you're thinking.
I know, sometimes I'm really thinking, and I am really thinking, but it's okay.
So if you're going to see paint underbind, when will you see it? Does it generally happen quickly? Does it happen over time?
You know, it happens. Sometimes you see it happening during the varnishing stage. The varnish will streak the paint. Sometimes as you're painting a layer on top of another layer, it's like the under layer just infinitely keeps coming into the layer on top.
Ah.
So that's what happens. I'm going to put this here. And then this one kind of comes out here. And so now I'm going to, I've got this little kind of well-defined bit there. There's an opening. And then I'll have to put some yellow back in here and work it. Ugh. Butterfly. I grab some glaze. Just, you know, I'll come back and work that space because it was too much. Right. And then again, work out what you can work out. You know, these are detailed bits, and you're just kind of saying, all right, I'm gonna get into this. I accept this detail. Accept the detail that you're up against. That's what I generally do, is accept the detail that I'm up against. And you gotta know I feel pretty okay about it, because it came at this like, oh, let's just paint this live.
Yeah.
Means that I'm not thinking it's not like so challenging you couldn't just do it. You know, for sure, Le Belle Dame was much more challenging. I'm using the glazing to make sure that this is slightly grayed. But I could also come in and just do this slightly grayed paint here. See, that's also fine.
So I have to say, Ian always brings in the Star Wars references.
All right, what Ewok did what to us today?
Oh, no. He and I have a little bit of a different opinion. So he tends to side with the Empire and believes...
I've noticed that Ian is very Empire-oriented, which is super disturbing.
Well, no, I think...
I guess they have cookies, is what I've heard.
I've heard they
come with cookies, and that's been a real attractor in their recruiting.
They have some good clothes. I'm going to give it to them. They have some nice style.
All right, now I can get my... Ooh, that was really challenging, guys. And look, sometimes it's challenging for me, too.
Yeah, but Ian, don't go into the woods. The Ewoks will just eat you. They protect the forest. They're happy, cuddly creatures.
No, they're not.
Well, as long as you're a forest creature, they are. But if you're like...
A Jedi.
Or anybody else, they might just eat you.
All right, so I'm enforcing the black that I'm seeing right here.
Yes.
You see I'm enforcing the black? And then I'm going to come back. I've lost some yellow. So I'm going to come back with a little yellow and white.
Now, what brush is that?
This is still my number two shader, short handle, Simply Simmons.
Okay.
And I'm going to just make sure that I have the yellow right here, like I'm seeing in the wing. Now, I've got to come with some white also in a minute, but I'm not going to worry about that quite yet because I'm still blacklining the sucker. I haven't even done legs. You know, where you need to improve the quality of the black paint by going over with another coat, definitely do that. How's he looking?
That looks so good.
Breathe.
I mean, like, it's so amazing from when you take a step back. It's so cool.
Now, again, I'm having to extrapolate a lot of wing because I have a plant in front of it.
Right.
So what I've got to do is just make sure that I try to be as true to the picture as I can. You know, as true to all of that as is possible. But, you know, it can be hard. I'm going to do a very fine line vein and then a very fine line vein. And something is clearly happening here. What's interesting to me is I seem to see what I feel I'm looking at is a circle. And then a little line happening out here. Again, extrapolating. Extrapolation can be hard. But you just gotta not let anything really panic you or throw you. What's always most important in the painting is just finishing it. You always paint it better later in your life anyways. So no point in getting too wrapped up about it now. All right. I think what I have going on here is a scallop.
Now, if someone didn't want to do the same background, could they still get the butterfly to look the same?
Yeah, just fast forward to where I'm doing the butterfly.
But for, like, the background glazing and stuff, you just have to work that out a little different?
If they want to go a different way on their background, have fun.
No problem.
I'm not going to come to your house and say, you know, I painted it this way.
It'll work.
You know, and you should have painted it exactly like that. No, this is not that class. All right. I'm going to come back with the white here. Almost feeling like, you know, oh, it's such a thing. We're going to make sure that we've got these little bits in. We'll come back with our white accents as we can. And just define what we can define. What's wonderful is that generally little beings like this are very variable. And you've just got to capture the essence of what they've got going on. So don't stress too much. The legs are a little stressful. No, I'm just kidding. Don't stress about any of it. I'm just getting these patterns. You can always come back and add more yellow paint. You can always come back and add white. You're building what's happening here in little tiny bricks. If we were to paint a hyper-realistic drop of water just dropping down, right? Well, how would we do that? We would do it, we'd break it down in small steps. Take it down to its small area. Recognize that we might be at our canvas for a minute.
Yeah.
And that's okay.
It's really not too bad. We're at about, what is it, an hour and 40 minutes or right in there right now? So we've done good.
We're really going to be done pretty soon. So
yeah, this has been trucking right along. People have been really enjoying it out here, Simon, so you don't know.
Aww.
We've had like 360 people here the entire time. It's been crazy. We had a really full house today, so thank you guys for coming. Don't forget to share this with your friends. Like, comment, subscribe. Hit those buttons down below. And post your picture up on Facebook. So we can see that. Now, I'm going to go sneeze for a moment.
Are you going to go sneeze? All right. So we're doing actually pretty darn good.
Darn good.
Uh-huh.
I have the sneezes.
Do you have the sneezes?
So many sneezes.
Well, we've got this going, haven't we?
That looks so cool. Here's the thing is that I'm really close up on it, right?
Yeah.
And so you can really see, but when you go bang and step there, step out and see this. Look, I'll let you see what you see.
That's looking good.
That's so good.
It's good.
It's so cool.
It's okay, that's another thing. That actually illustrates a very good point. When you're doing this up close, it's always a hot mess, guys. Don't even freak out yet. It's too early to freak out. You guys will always be like, it's not looking right. Well, you're 2 inches away. Back up. That's an important thing to know. If you're 2 inches away, back up.
So thank you, guys. I look over here in chat, and I'm like, everyone's saying bless you, John. I'm like, oh, my gosh. Why would they be saying bless me? What did I do? I'm like, oh, I sneezed. Thank you. I was like, did something go wrong?
If I can have my picture back again for just a second.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
Picture back again for just a second. All right, now we're going to do some legs and a little antenna. So he's got a little antenna that comes up out here. And this is neat curl back, so I want to just...
Oh, yeah.
There we go. His little friend. Little feather back. And then... Two little friends are somewhere delicately here at the flower, having a little moment.
They're doing flowery things with that.
Yeah, see? Just delicate. I'm real light on the legs. Now this leg has a little sort of forward joint. We'll acknowledge that. And a little kind of thing here. they have these little bendy joints. You definitely want to show those bends and recognize. You can do another nice defined leg right here. It's got a little joint. Look at that. And then on the far legs, just do them super light. They're there, but they're light. See how they are?
Just imply them over there?
Just imply them over there.
Because they could be washed out because of the light.
They can be. Now, and I'm going to rinse this brush off. I'm going to do an interesting little thing here. Interesting little thing. I'm going to get just a smidge of yellow and some white. And the brush is real dry.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to come right here at the belly, and I'm going to add just a little bit of fur.
Ooh, little fuzzy stuff.
Little fuzzy stuff. Fuzz it up. I'm going to fuzz it up. Now, I've got some fluid paint of white. And there's a couple places I gotta do some stuff. And then I probably could have done it with just the regular white. I don't think you actually probably don't even think it's really a problem.
This is great.
I'm going to take a little of my yellow into just any of my whites, fluids or otherwise. And I'm making a very light color. And I'm going to add this little tip to this wing. Just a little bit. And then I'm going to come... And along these little scallops, add just a little bit. Maybe he's got a little bit coming in here, and then there's a little scallop there. And then there's maybe a little bit there. And then I'm going to get a little blue. Blue, 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 blue. And a lot of white. And I'm going to paint the little blue, a lot of white. And a little moon, a little even more blue. A little dust there. Little bit, little bit, little bits. Little bits, little bits, little bits. Oh, I wish that was almost other places. And then just to make sure I've got it, I'm going to make sure that my black here at this back wing.
Oh, yeah.
Is well conceived. Maybe these little spots, just a couple little spots. Make sure this is well conceived.
What do you mean by that, well conceived?
That it's not too loose. It's been paid attention to, and I've focused my eye and my artist mind on it and said, where does this line need to be sharp to tell the story as I'm seeing it?
Gotcha.
I'm inclined to grab some just yellow right here in these spots. Maybe even here.
Just pop it up a little bit.
Pop it up a little bit. Not because that's how it is, but because it needs to be that
to stand out.
Really read.
Oh, wow. That looks so
good. All right. Guys, I think we did it.
That is amazing.
I hope it is.
It really is.
Oh, wait, one more thing.
Okay.
Okay, just one more thing. It's a weird small touch, but it'll bug me if it's not there for like all week. And then I'll be like, why didn't I show him that? This wing has to have a highlight. It's a mild one, but it has to have it, I feel.
Oh, yeah.
Just a little bit it just has to have that. All right, how's that?
I think that's great.
All right, okay.
There's our cinnamon doing this.
I'm even
painting.
Willing to sign this sucker. Oh. That's how into it I am.
I pushed the wrong button there. So that's
what'd you push?
I missed. Well, see, I didn't push
Are we
that.
Saying goodbye?
This button. There we go. I'm not saying goodbye. I'm
all
just
right,
trying
we're
to.
Not? Okay.
Well, soon. But I mean, I have all the wrong buttons pushed.
I hope that was a really interesting drill down for everybody. And, you know, I think sometimes seeing me work a project out, it wouldn't have been significantly shorter even if I had, like, rehearsed the painting, because you just have to do the layers.
Yeah.
The layers of the layers. I'm just signing it.
We're just seeing you put that little Sherpa in there.
Yeah. Weird little signature. All right. Can I see on the big screen? I don't know how it looks.
Oh, yeah. Hold on a second.
Because I'm all up on it, and I got to get back from it.
Ooh. Isn't that good?
We can put the picture up. How'd we do?
I think we did pretty good. Hold on a second. Let me go over here and See if I can. Oops.
And really, you know, if you think about it, most sipping paints, like complicated painting, is 3 hours anyways, and we did it in 2.
Yeah. I can't. I'm having.
That's okay.
I'm just not doing it, okay?
You can't find it, or it's not clicking.
It's.
Sometimes it doesn't click. This is new. This is new kit that we have. I'm really pleased with this.
There it is.
I forgot something.
What did you forget?
The red.
Oh, you did.
Because I didn't. I just see. See, my brain is like, stop, you're forgetting it. And I'm like, what is it? And we have to finish it. So we're back to it. We're not done.
All right.
Stop celebrating.
All right. No.
Don't go away.
Okay. All right. Hold on. Fine. No celebration here.
None. I'm going to get some glaze just so it's got a little more flow. Can you give me my butterfly back? Because that's how I ended up without any red. All right. This is what we forgot, guys. And it's important.
And so.
It's important. Was so important and we forgot it.
We'll give you some other music while you're working on that.
It was just really important.
There we go.
Look how much a big deal that red is. Oh my gosh, I can't believe we almost left him without his colors.
Manisha? So one of them.
I'm just lightly dusting this red into it.
She caught that they were missing some red, and she was like, "Wait, what about the red?"
You know what? See that, you know, again, that could still happen even in the rehearsal, though, guys. Don't even be like, "Oh, it wouldn't happen." No, it would still happen.
Janine's like,
"Can we see any red I'm missing? I think I got the red."
We get the red in the flower there too. A little red in that flower. A little red there.
To finish these paintings. They're so funny. Well, hopefully people won't go away when we're celebrating the completion. Sometimes you sign your painting and then you come back to it later and go, oh, did I have all his red?
Yeah.
Whew, that was scary. Oh, you never want to do that on the internet. In your own privacy of your own studio, you can completely flop on your face. Because no one's going to know, but on the internet, they'll tell you. All right. How'd we do? Let's look at it. Okay. Now it's the thing, isn't it?
Now you're feeling it's the thing.
And don't you kind of feel my heart, Bokeh? I kind of like that. The lensing. Isn't that kind of cool?
Yeah, I like
it's cool.
That.
It's very cool. We'll have to see what Pinterest thinks of it. We won't really know if we're cool until we put it on Pinterest or Instagram. That's when we find out if we really nailed it. Because they judge right there.
I think so.
With the shares and the likes.
I think that's pretty good there.
I feel like we really did that, and, you know, that's something, so this is a project, there's nothing in the project particularly that is not accessible for new artists. What it is, the difference between what we're going through is I painted, I don't know, like this year alone, how many paintings? I don't know. I paint more than daily. I paint more than every day, right? I might do 2 paintings in a day, 3 paintings in a day. There's a lot of experience here. So when I'm looking at this, I'm like, okay, I got to blend this. I have resolved these things before. So I'm very comfortable with the journey that I'm going to be taking. And you being new, just haven't painted a lot of paintings yet. This is 100% why I don't critique you yet.
Yeah.
It's not that I don't think critiques are valuable. Critiques are super valuable. And, you know, hearing what other artists think is super valuable. But you need 20 paintings, 30 paintings under your belt before you have even enough understanding of what's going on with your paint and you as an artist and your materials and all of that stuff, where you could even maybe hear somebody and have it not seem abstract and attacky.
Yeah.
That's what it is. If it benefited you guys, I would do it nonstop. It just doesn't at this stage. And that is wonderful. And when it went, like, Angela Green just had a great critique.
Yeah.
But she was ready for that, and that was wonderful.
And today we've got, this is a big painting today. We've gone about to 2 hours today. So
it's the biggest one we've done in a while. Seriously,
yeah.
Look what we did. And we kind of even came to YouTube and said, oh yeah, YouTube likes realism. We got realism here. We just show you how to do it. I mean, I could put this on 2 minutes and have it be a time lapse and you could see me do it. But I want to see you do it.
And so post those pictures up on Facebook. Post them on Twitter. We love seeing you guys. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share. And post your pictures for us. Right, Cinnamon?
Yes! Painted! He wants to be painted. Don't you love him?
Yes. We love you guys. We'll see you again soon. Is that good?
That's perfect.
All right, guys. We love you guys.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Oh, and hopefully... Oh, hold on. There we go.